I'm Kathy Holland, and I'm representing the neuropsychologists in the department who band together to invite Dr. Bondi here. We're very excited to have him here. He spent the last couple days, and we've had some very interesting discussions. We reintroduced him to sopapillas the first night he was here, and he was ecstatic. So that was a good sign from the very beginning. I don't know how many of you know what Dr. Bondi has done. He's a he got his degree from University of Arizona with Al Kazniak, who's very well known for research in normal aging and Parkinson's disease. And then he went to UCSD and really has been there ever since, completed a postdoc, and now is professor of psychiatry at UCSD, has been funded continuously throughout his 20-some year career at this point by NIH and also by Department of Veterans Affairs.
NIA,
okay. And the focus of his work has been dementia, which is what he's going to be talking about with us today. Dr. Bondi is extremely highly regarded within the neuropsychology community. Is well known for his as a thought leader in dementia and especially differentiation of normal aging, mild cognitive impairment, and dementia. He's published over 120 papers in highly regarded journals within neuropsychology, neurology, and psychiatry, and has received multiple mid-career, or I guess early career awards, and he's just waiting to get a little older to get the mid-career and late career awards, so we're waiting for that. So at any rate, I take great pleasure in being able to introduce to you Dr. Mark Bondi, who's going to be talking about revisions to criteria for diagnosis of Alzheimer's and MCI. Please help me welcome him.
Thank you so much, Kathy, for that warm welcome. And I just want to take the opportunity to thank everyone for their hospitality over these past couple of days, and to thank you for the kind invitation to come and speak this afternoon at this Grand Rounds on a variety of topics that are, truth be told, in a state of flux. In terms of the revisions to various criteria for a diagnosis of dementing conditions, and particularly Alzheimer's disease and some of the borderland states such as mild cognitive impairment. And this is a formal setting, but if folks want to entertain questions in the midst of the presentation that don't swamp the full length of the presentation, then I'm happy to entertain questions along the way. Okay. So in terms of what I hope to accomplish today is some basic review of the original set of criteria for the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease that were originally offered back in 1984 from the then NINCDS and ADRDA consensus work group that Guy McCann and colleagues convened for the clinical diagnosis of the disease, of Alzheimer's disease. And just last year, Guy McCann, some 28 years later, reconvened a work group at the behest of the National Institute on Aging and Alzheimer's Association. As you know, they shortened that name from the Alzheimer's Disease and Related Disorders Association to just the Alzheimer's Association, so that helped with the acronym. And so what I'd like to do is sort of do a basic comparison of some of those original criteria to these new criteria, and focus in on what some of those changes are in the criteria. And obviously, in that 28-year epoch, the notion of mild cognitive impairment was introduced by Ron Peterson and colleagues from the Mayo Clinic and Winblad and others. And so we'd like to discuss some of those criteria and just briefly touch on Marilyn Albert's work group on criteria for MCI due to Alzheimer's disease. So that's the new criteria there. And then the third work group that was convened back in 2011 was headed by Risa Sperling and colleagues, and that was an attempt to identify changes that may occur during the preclinical period, so during the asymptomatic period of Alzheimer's disease. And so we'll go over some of those suggested research criteria for preclinical Alzheimer's disease detection would involve. And then we'll examine their use in various ways. Okay, so neurodegenerative conditions of late life, as you all know, involve slowly accruing neuron losses that evolve over some period of time, and it's not necessarily completely understood how long that preclinical period may last, and obviously may vary between individuals. But suffice it to say that it could be a decade or more of asymptomatic accumulation of some of the primary pathologies that we now know as Alzheimer's disease, and that these changes will evolve over some years. And so what we're really discussing is a continuum of that neurodegeneration, although the labels that we assign to them are for convenience purposes. That is, we expect that there's some threshold that is crossed wherein one has significant memory and other cognitive impairments that are sufficient to interfere with one's daily function, and then one is diagnosed with dementia. Preceding that are some changes in cognition that are not thought to interfere with one's daily functioning, and that would be given an MCI label. And then even preceding that, there may be some mild or subtle cognitive changes that may not even register as impairments on a neuropsychological exam, but would then, in retrospect, be identified as prodromal signs of the disease. So that's what we'll be talking about along that continuum over some years. And as I said, each of those three articles that were published last year in the journal Alzheimer's and Dementia will focus on pieces of that continuum. What is Alzheimer's disease? Well, here's Alois Alzheimer, a very distinguished looking gentleman. He was a big guy, though. He was upwards 6'2", 6'3", I believe, and a big sprawling German neuropathologist and psychiatrist. And he came in contact with a number of individuals at the local asylum that began to have features that were somewhat unique from what he had come across with others. And he came across this one individual by the name of Auguste D. And to quote directly from his 1907 paper, he said, "Clinical observation alone made the case appear so unusual that it could not be classified as one of the recognized illnesses of the day. And it showed anatomical characteristics which set it apart from all recognized cases. The first symptom was that the woman showed an idea that she was jealous of her husband. She thought that her husband was having an affair, and I think history proves her to be right in that account. Nevertheless, her memory was awful. Soon she developed a rapid loss of memory." And Alzheimer was at the right place at the right time. The silver staining technique had just been discovered, and so he applied it to a number of these individuals' brain slices and basically discovered the characteristic lesions that are now associated with his name. So, a typical cognitive deficits associated with Alzheimer's disease include a prominent amnesia with rapid forgetting of material over time, executive dysfunction, some speeded perceptual motor integration deficits, language production and comprehension deficits, and trailing the list typically is the visual spatial impairments in the latter stages of the disease. But it is the significant deficit in episodic memory that usually is considered to be the earliest and most prominent manifestation of the cognitive changes in Alzheimer's disease. And Alzheimer himself wrote, her memory is seriously impaired. If objects are shown to her, she names them correctly, but almost immediately afterward, she has forgotten everything. So her Boston naming test performance, object naming might have been fairly good, it might have held up, but she clearly was not remembering material, particularly over time. So we now know that Alzheimer had discovered the characteristic lesions that are associated with his name, that is the extracellular insoluble amyloid plaque, as well as the intracellular neurofibrillary tangle. Here are a couple of representative slices of the plaque and tangle. And we'll get into some of that a little bit in a little bit more detail. So with that basic backdrop, Guy McCann and colleagues convened a work group that was designed to help improve upon the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. And so what they originally came up with were a couple of various categories. One, which was called probable Alzheimer's disease, where the history and pattern of memory and other cognitive deficits were thought to be highly likely to be Alzheimer's disease, probably Alzheimer's disease. And then possible Alzheimer's disease was a bit of bet hedging, where there could be other possible contributing causes to the cognitive symptoms or some atypical presentation. And then they also had a third category called definite Alzheimer's disease, which was the autopsy confirmation of sufficient neuropathology in the brains of those individuals to be called definite Alzheimer's disease. So it was an autopsy confirmation of the diagnosis. And over the years, with those clinical criteria, we've gotten around 90% accurate at the academic medical centers and Alzheimer's disease centers across the country. We're about 90% accurate in terms of identifying the clinical diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease and seeing Alzheimer's disease confirmation at autopsy. And I snuck in MCI here as as a reminder that we'll also look at MCI, but it as a diagnostic entity, it didn't come online till the early 90s. Basically is thought to represent an intermediate stage or borderland where there are mild cognitive symptoms, memory and other deficits, but relatively preserved daily function. So fast forward 27, 28 years, and the new philosophy from the reconvened work group is such that it focuses more now on biomarkers in the hopes that it adds information about pathology to help buttress the diagnosis of it and may lead to greater confidence in earlier diagnosis and will hopefully, at the end of the day, enable earlier interventions. Okay, so the original criteria was that a dementia was established by clinical exam, documented by global cognitive screening tests and confirmed by neuropsychological testing. Deficits occurred in memory and another area of cognition, so there had to be two or more domains of cognition that were impaired. Had to be a progressive worsening from a previously higher level, was not due to an act of delirium, and that there was an absence of other disorders that were thought to be potentially causal. So, most of that material, or most of that criteria, are instantiated in the current clinical criteria. And the newer consensus work group criteria have the following enhancements. That is, there could be an increase in certainty if you show within-person change on serial evaluations. So if a person declines over the course of a couple or more evaluations, that may help be helpful in increasing one's certitude that they're looking at early Alzheimer's disease. If one is gene positive for one of the three known gene mutations for Alzheimer's disease, either one of the two presenilin gene mutations or the APP gene mutation, obviously that will help inform an increased certainty. And then thirdly, the issue of biomarker positivity. And that can be from a variety of sources that include CSF biomarkers, cerebral spinal fluid biomarkers, with the advent of amyloid imaging, radioligands that may bind to the amyloid beta protein and thereby assay the level of amyloid burden currently in the brain, as well as assays of glucose metabolism via positron emission tomography scans. Fluorodeoxyglucose is the typical one, or structural MRI renderings of either global or specific regional measures of atrophy, particularly in the medial temporal lobe and the hippocampus. So those are a variety of different biomarkers. And here they are in more schematic form. There are MRI measures that can take place in terms of global atrophy. Ventricular enlargement is a proxy for global atrophy oftentimes. And there are regional assays of atrophy rates in particular medial temporal lobe regions. There are functional assays of change, whether it's functional MRI or with positron emission tomography. And then some of the more recent assays in terms of biochemical markers for the disease through cerebral spinal fluid, concentrations of amyloid beta protein fragments, tau protein and phosphorylated tau protein fragments, and so on. So those are what are the typical biomarker assays that are currently in use for diagnostic purposes. Now, in terms of the underlying pathology of Alzheimer's disease, it's been known for some time, and particularly the seminal work of the neuropathologists of Brock and Brock back in 1991, rather, they published this elegant study that showed the evolution of neurofibrillary tangle pathology in Alzheimer's disease. And it did appear to have a particular predilection or march through the brain that began and was limited to the entorhinal and transentorhinal region of the medial temporal lobes. And all of this would appear to take place asymptomatically or preclinically. So none of these changes were thought to be severe enough to cause changes in one's cognitive abilities or everyday functioning. Over time, continual involvement of those same regions with additional spread to adjacent regions like the hippocampus, as well as to other association areas, lateral temporal lobe and frontal cortical association areas, would then become involved in these middle stages. And then finally, in the latter stages, with clinically evident Alzheimer's disease, we see a severe involvement of the medial temporal lobe in terms of the accumulation of tangle pathology with its spread to adjacent lateral temporal cortices and frontal cortices. And only really the primary sensory and motor areas are typically spared from the ravages of the tangle pathology. But it's an important point that there seems to be a rather interesting predilection of the tangle pathology for certain areas of the brain And that happens preclinically or during the early manifestations of the disorder. Oftentimes, folks are diagnosed with MCI if they have tangle pathology that is represented in stage 3 or 4 severity in terms of the Brock and Brock staging. And then only really stages 5 and 6 tend to show the clinically evident early dementia associated with Alzheimer's disease. And that's very, it's interesting from a cognitive perspective because that progression tends to map on very nicely to what we know to be the progression, the typical progression of the cognitive deficits associated with the disease. That is, we get this early involvement of the medial temporal lobe that corresponds to difficulty with learning and remembering new material and the appearance of rapid forgetting of that material. So Alzheimer himself found that to be the case, that her memory was seriously impaired, and that seemed to be the most prominent manifestation of Alzheimer's disease, and that tends to be the case today. We see deficits in episodic memory as being the earliest sign. And that's followed by involvement of the lateral temporal lobes, which typically invoke some language and semantic memory changes, and frontal cortices with executive functions and so on. So the degree of correspondence or the correlation of the tangle pathology tends to be fairly good with the cognitive manifestations of Alzheimer's disease. And we did a study a few years back in which we looked at composites of episodic memory, semantic memory, and executive function in the 2 years prior to a change in diagnosis. So these were either normals who changed to MCI or changed from normal to AD or MCI to AD. So prior to a change in diagnosis, we see that folks were performing about equally poorly in terms of their episodic as well as semantic memory, and it was a bit more severe than their executive function. So we were seeing this mapping, if you will, of the medial and lateral temporal cortices and its associated cognitive functions. It's a simplistic, perhaps overly simplistic, localizationist perspective, but but one that sort of is borne out in terms of what we know about the medial temporal lobes driving episodic memory, and that the lateral temporal lobes are important for semantic memory or supportive of a semantic memory. Now, in terms of tau, again, so we see this correlation between the tangle pathology and cortical thinning within those medial and lateral temporal regions. So that's a nice correspondence, and then further correspondence to the cognitive deficit. What about with amyloid? Well, the answer is not so much. Amyloid is more diffusely spread, it appears to be, and it is historically not very well correlated at all with the particular cognitive deficits that are associated with the disease. And it doesn't seem to have that predilection for certain areas in the brain that clearly the march of tangle pathology seems to have. And so here's a study that was published a couple of years ago that basically showed that amyloid was not correlated at all with a whole brain measure of brain atrophy over 1 year period, whether it was compact amyloid or total amyloid. And so forth. So there is some distinction to be born at the neuropathologic level between the correspondence between those two lesions, those two types of lesions, and the cognitive manifestations of Alzheimer's disease. And I think that has some importance as we begin to look more at the biomarker changes associated with the disease. So what about some of these other biomarkers, like FDG PET? Here's a normal brain in which we see very good glucose metabolism sort of across the board. Mild cognitive impairment states may have a relative reduction within the temporal parietal regions. That seems to be a fairly characteristic change in MCI, temporal parietal hypometabolism, as well as some associated anterior cingulate and other frontal metabolic changes, reductions. And then in Alzheimer's disease, despite the glaring ventricular enlargement, that may be more informative than the actual PET scan in this case, but you also see more severe reductions of the temporal parietal metabolic rates as well. So that those seem to be characteristic assays within FDG PET. And they may also be helpful, particularly if an individual may be younger, they may be more helpful in differentiating Alzheimer's from frontotemporal lobar degeneration. So in the case of a Pick's disease patient, for example, you'll show more characteristic fronto hypometabolism as opposed to the more posterior temporal parietal hypometabolism in Alzheimer's disease. And those types of scanning techniques may be helpful for differentiation of AD from FTD. So another type of imaging assay is that of amyloid imaging, another PET imaging technique. And this is one in which the Pittsburgh Compound D was the first to appear and has been utilized with great vigor in the research community over the last decade or so, maybe. There's probably a decade of experience now with PIB. And it's a radioligand with a very short half-life, so few centers can actually perform this type of technique unless they have a cyclotron right on site, right next door to the PET imager, so that they can walk that ligand right over. And it's got a very, very short 10, 15 minute half-life, something like that. So at any rate, with this technique, it will bind to the brain amyloid, and so one can get a measure, an in vivo measure of one's amyloid burden. And so here are some characteristic scans of individuals. This is a 73-year-old, healthy, cognitively normal older adult who has a low level of amyloid binding, contrasted with an Alzheimer's disease patient of similar age with a high degree of amyloid binding. And in when it comes to mild cognitive impairment, it's with some folks you may see a great deal of amyloid binding, and some you may not see so much amyloid binding. So that sort of belies some of the difficulty with using this technique, in that it may not it, it there can be high amounts of amyloid in cognitively normal individuals, and that seems to be the case at least a fair minority of the time. Okay, so in April of this year, FDA approved the first PET tracer of amyloid for use with the general public. It tends to be a bit more user-friendly than PIB. So it's here, and folks can potentially go out and get their own amyloid imaging scan if they so choose. And what seems to be the case is that with low levels of amyloid binding with florbetapir F18 or amyvid, it has, with all of these individuals for the FDA study, these were all individuals who got florbetapir scan and then at some point died, and so they had autopsy verification of their amyloid burden, okay? So here is the florbetapir scan and very, very little A-beta pathology at autopsy, an intermediate level of amyloid binding with florbetapir and an intermediate level of amyloid pathology and so on. And so it does seem to be a relatively specific tracer that does target amyloid binding quite well. So there's sort of a broad overview of some of the biomarkers that are currently available and typically in use that may be helpful for the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. With that said, McCann and colleagues have basically assigned different levels of probability depending on the number of variables that are available to the diagnostician And so here we have the notion that probable AD dementia that is on the basis of the clinical criteria alone, that is, we make the diagnosis on the basis of the thorough neurologic, neuropsychological evaluations, and so forth, but we have no biomarker information that's available for that diagnosis. So whether we have any amyloid imaging or CSF biomarkers, no. Do we have any measures of structural MRI atrophy or FDG PET? No. So that's the basic clinical diagnosis that we've all been working with for many years. Now, if we have some level of biomarker availability, then it bumps to the next level. So for example, one can potentially increase their level of confidence if they have a positive scan result. Say they have significant, they have a marker of hippocampal atrophy or something like that, which is thought to be a positive marker of the neuronal injury associated with Alzheimer's disease. That combined with the clinical criteria bumps up the level of informativeness to an intermediate level, or vice versa. If they don't have any of these other markers of neuronal injury, but they may have CSF concentrations of A beta or tau or both, then to be registered as positive, that may increase one's confidence in the diagnosis of the disease. And then if one has all three categories, that improves to a high classification. So that is how McCann et al. Are beginning to use biomarker data to help buttress one's confidence in the diagnosis of the disease. Well, is that the way to go? I suppose in some ways, yes. But as long as we have full disclosure that some of those variables may not perform as well as some other variables, potentially. And so are all those variables equally viable? That may or may not be the case. And I think it behooves us to investigate each of those with a fair degree of scrutiny. So for example, when it comes to amyloid imaging, they've identified folks with high amyloid burden via amyloid imaging scans and those with low amyloid burdens. And one would suppose that there may be cognitive distinctions between those with high amyloid as opposed to low amyloid. Well, in this study by Eisenstein that was published in 2008, across a large number of cognitive measures, there were absolutely no differences between those two groups when it came to learning, memory, language function, perceptual abilities, et cetera, across all of these neuropsychological measures, there were no differences. And I pointed out yesterday, that's not quite true. There was a p-value of 0.02 here on this one measure of word list delayed recall. Unfortunately, it was the amyloid positive group that outperformed the amyloid negative group. So again, not in the direction that one would hope for amyloid positivity. So it has forced some modification of what we think may represent the importance of amyloid imaging in terms of identifying each of these different stages along the continuum from preclinical Alzheimer's disease to MCI to clinically evident or diagnosed Alzheimer's disease. And what Cliff Jack has stated is that there's probably little additional accumulation within these latter stages of amyloid burden. There's very little annual change in PIB binding rates, and there's very little in terms of differentiating these three clinical conditions on the basis of amyloid alone. It's still unknown whether this is this is occurring over decades, or if there's some accelerating curve on the matter of some years as opposed to decades where amyloid is accumulating in folks. And so the prevailing model of neurodegeneration and the cascade of events that occur across the continuum of preclinical Alzheimer's disease to clinically evident Alzheimer's disease has been offered by Jack and Weiner and others, and occurs as such that amyloid amyloid accumulation represents a necessary but not sufficient condition for the eventual cascade of neurodegeneration leading to Alzheimer's disease. So A-beta will accumulate over a period of time preclinically, followed by tau-mediated neuronal dysfunction and injury, and followed then by brain functional and structural changes, and then the occurrence, the late occurrence of cognitive and ultimately clinical functional deficits that are required then for the diagnosis of the disease. So that seems to be the prevailing model of neurodegeneration with respect to these various biomarkers associated with the disease. And that's basically what Risa Sperling has offered in her third article on the proposed framework for preclinical Alzheimer's disease. And she separates it into three stages, the first of which is this asymptomatic amyloidosis, where one may begin to see amyloid burden via amyloid imaging or CSF biomarkers of A-beta. And then the second stage would overlay neurodegeneration that then would be thought to be reflected of the tau accumulation. And then finally, when both are present at some level over some time, then we begin to see some of these subtle cognitive declines. So it's just a different way of proposing or depicting that staging of neurodegeneration with the various biomarkers. So what about MCI? Well, here were some of the original criteria that were associated with what Peterson has been championing for some time. And it included this notion of an objective memory impairment, otherwise normal general cognitive function, intact ADLs or activities of daily living, and otherwise not demented. And because they worked in a memory clinic, oftentimes the subjective memory complaint was a ubiquitous part of that. So folks with subjective memory complaints would therefore go to a memory clinic for evaluation. Okay, so that was the typical criteria that were originally offered by Peterson and colleagues, and really it was with a more limited notion of being an amnestic prodrome of Alzheimer's disease. So that's how they originally offered it. And here were a representative example that there was a memory complaint, subjective memory complaint, that delayed recall of a memory measure was typically observed to be impaired. Normal general cognitive function was typically defined across research studies as a 24 to 30 on the mini mental state exam, and a global clinical dementia rating scale score typically of 0.5, borderland between 0, no impairment, 1, mild but evident impairment. And then they modified that original criteria, which seemed to be a more limited notion of a single domain of memory difficulty. But then they thought, well, we should expand this to capture everything else. And so in that expansion, they bifurcated it to be either amnestic type MCI or a non-amnestic type. And was it a single domain of cognition that was impaired, or was it multiple domains? So that's how they ended up in these four final baskets of MCI. Why would that be important? Well, what they suggested was that there may be different etiologies at play and that these different subtypes of MCI may represent prodromes of various types of dementia, whether it's Alzheimer's or non-Alzheimer type dementias. So they would contend that amnestic MCI would be much more associated with an Alzheimer type dementia, whereas perhaps non-amnestic MCI subtypes may be associated with non-AD dementias like frontotemporal dementia or dementia with Lewy bodies or perhaps a vascular dementia. And so Marilyn Albert and colleagues have used this approach and then incorporated the use of biomarkers to help increase one's confidence with a diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment. And so here again, are markers of A-beta pathology present? And if so, they will help inform one's confidence in the diagnosis, or are markers of neuronal injury present? So how helpful are these subtyping schemes for diagnosing mild cognitive impairment? Well, the work of Julie Snyder at Rush University, along with David Bennett's group and the Memory and Aging Project, have done some really interesting work to suggest not so much. So they've taken a number of folks and studied them over many years, and over 120 or so have died at the stage of mild cognitive impairment. And so they've then identified the lesion and neuropathology associated with these two broad subtypes of MCI, whether it's amnestic or non-amnestic. And basically what you can see from this bifurcation of MCI, that whether you're labeled with amnestic MCI or non-amnestic MCI, about a third of the time you'll have Alzheimer neuropathology present, and in isolation. So only plaque and tangle pathology sufficient for the definite diagnosis of Alzheimer disease. In another third, you have infarcts or a combination of Alzheimer and cerebrovascular disease. And in another third, neither. Perhaps dementia with Lewy bodies or neocortical Lewy body inclusions or something along those lines. So basically, if you compare the two maps here, they're very, very similar. That is, one might expect to have other non-AD pathology more present in non-amnestic MCI, but that's really not the case. What we're finding is a great deal of similarity in the underlying neuropathology, whether it's labeled amnestic or non-amnestic MCI. So what is the conclusion that one can draw? Well, the current nosology of MCI may not be doing a very good job of characterizing this underlying neuropathology. And here's another slide that I like to use from an article that was published that basically shows healthy older adults in terms of their PIB binding, their amyloid burden, and Alzheimer's disease patients in terms of their amyloid binding. And you can see that there's a great deal more binding in the Alzheimer group on average than in the normal control group. But you definitely get these pesky outliers that are difficult to explain based on the clinical presentation of that individual. And then you have the MCI group where their PIB binding may actually go from the lowest low of the normal controls to the highest high of the Alzheimer's disease group. So how helpful then is amyloid imaging at recognizing these various clinical states? Perhaps not so much. And that part of the difficulty may lie in our current characterizations of MCI. How are we diagnosing MCI, and is it benefiting us to even bifurcated into amnestic versus non-amnestic forms or single versus multi-domain forms if at the end of the day the underlying neuropathology is not very distinct between those two labels? Okay, so again, this is the prevailing model of neurodegeneration, which is initiated by A-beta, which then promulgates this cascade of neurodegeneration involving tau, structural and functional brain changes, followed by cognitive and functional impairments. Well, over the last couple of years, we've had a variety of really interesting studies that have been published that have begun to examine these biomarkers alongside one another, and they also throw in a critical cognitive measure just for fun. And what really seems to be happening, a lot of these are based on retrospective data analyses from the Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging Initiative, which has been just a panoply of opportunity for investigators. It's open source data that's been assembled across multiple sites, and so and now they're, I believe, they could be on ADNI 2 at this point, I think. So there was an original ADNI, an ADNI Go with some of that stimulus NIH funding, and now there's ADNI 2. And so what you're able to then examine is a large number of individuals at various degrees of clinical pathology and with a variety of these biomarker techniques. And so the studies that are beginning to be published in this area are showing in the same group of subjects a variety of these techniques, whether it's genetic risk via apolipoprotein epsilon 4 allele status, FDG PET, hippocampal volume, of the CSF biomarkers, or in this particular study by Landau, this is the total learning variable across five trials of the Ray Auditory Verbal Learning Test. So if one achieved a score of 33 and below, one was labeled as positive for a bad learning episode on the Ray AVLT. And when you look at the receiver operating characteristics of each of these individual variables, well, it turns out that the best differentiation of Alzheimer's disease from normalcy or of MCI from normalcy is being driven by a simple learning measure. And it outperforms all of these other biomarkers. Another study by Heister showed basically the same thing, that the summary learning measure on the Ray Auditory Verbal Learning Test had the best differentiation of healthy aging subjects from Alzheimer's disease well above and beyond a variety of these other biomarkers. And this study did an interesting addition in which they combined these various biomarkers. So for example, if one had a positive finding on the learning measure, well, they were shown to have about a tenfold increase in risk for progressing to a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. That is, and if they were, or if they had a positive marker of atrophy in the hippocampus, again, they had a greater than tenfold increase in risk for progression. And if they had both markers present, that was close to a 30-fold increase in risk for progression to Alzheimer's disease over that particular follow-up period, which I believe was a 2 to 3 year follow-up period. And again, similar type of thing if you used the cognitive variable with the CSF markers. And then finally, this other study by Jedinak and colleagues that was published this year in NeuroImage is showing basically the same thing, that whether you're looking at hippocampal volume, A-beta, or tau, it's actually the 30-minute delayed recall score from the Ray Auditory Verbal Learning Test that appears to be the earliest marker of best predictor of progression to Alzheimer's disease and it outperforms all of these other biomarkers, and it certainly outperforms basic cognitive screening measures, whether it's the mini mental state exam, the Alzheimer's disease assessment scale, or the clinical dementia rating scale sum of boxes marker. So these obviously appear to be late arriving predictors of progression, but the important point is that a critical measure of episodic memory appears to be perhaps outperforming some of these other biomarkers. And so I think it turns this model somewhat on its head in the sense that rather than having all of these other events preceding cognition, and particularly episodic memory, it may be the case that memory changes are quite a sensitive harbinger of potential progression to Alzheimer's disease and may in fact outperform some of these other biomarkers. I've been kind of down on biomarkers, so I felt a need to say, well, when might they be helpful? And unfortunately, I had Gil Rabinovici up at UC San Francisco give a nice talk to help me with how they might be helpful. And he published this article last year, which basically makes a lot of sense, they might be more helpful if one has very mild changes. One may be sort of atypical in their presentation of changes that may help with differential diagnosis, or if one is perhaps younger in those changes. And those biomarkers, despite what I've said, it is the case at a global level that those who are PID positive will progress at greater rates to dementia, even if it at a cross-sectional point in time may not be that helpful. Earlier age of onset dementias are a little bit trickier in the sense that the base rates are oftentimes equal between Alzheimer's disease and frontotemporal dementias in terms of what we may be looking at. So having other biomarkers to examine whether we may be seeing frontotemporal changes as opposed to posterior changes may be helpful. And it might be helpful to rule out AD in patients with other conditions. Okay, and it will also play an important role in drug development and in clinical trials, because we're gonna have to assay levels of amyloid burden to see if a variety of these anti-amyloid therapies currently underway are showing what they're expected to show, which is clearance of amyloid. So put together a little bit of a case example here. And this was actually Rabinovici's patient that he kindly let me steal. And it was a 63-year-old practicing internist with a complaint of progressive worsening of word finding difficulties and characterized by struggling to come up with words that should be familiar to him, beginning to be embarrassing within social context as well as professionally. He just began to feel less efficient at accomplishing a variety of tasks, but really didn't complain of any other cognitive or physical symptoms, and it really hadn't impacted his daily function in any appreciable way. But on exams, he was within normal limits on most everything, including his neuropsychological evaluation, with the exception of object naming. He was down on his object naming performance, just mildly below normal limits on object naming. And they were able to do an FDG PET scan, and he had some very mild temporal parietal hypometabolism relative to normal. And he showed a fair degree of amyloid burden on his PIB imaging scan. And so if we were using the Albert et al. Criteria, we might characterize him as mild cognitive impairment, which would be non-amnestic in this case. It was a isolated language impairment. And he was positive for amyloid burden as well as for some neuronal injury a la temporoparietal hypometabolism. So that, in a sense, is how some of these criteria may be put to use, and they may be more helpful in certain cases rather than others. When might they not be so helpful? Well, as we've shown, they're not needed for diagnosis. We can still diagnose Alzheimer's disease clinically without the use of these biomarker instruments with a high degree of accuracy. We're already getting to 85 or 90% accuracy. And so how much are these expensive biomarker assays, and at times invasive biomarker assays, really improving upon that accuracy level? In terms of percentages, we're maybe buying 2, 3, 4% more accuracy overall. As I've shown, amyloid scans are positive oftentimes in about a third of cognitively normal individuals. They're not cheap, they're quite expensive. How helpful is this at the end of the day if we don't have current treatments on board with which to treat preclinical Alzheimer's disease in particular, since nothing can be done really at present? Now, some of the anti-amyloid therapies may be helpful, and the negative findings that have been disseminated in the literature recently, the notion is that they've been studying Alzheimer's disease and late mild cognitive impairments, where a lot of the ravages of the neurodegeneration has already occurred. And so even if you clear amyloid, it is thought to be too late at that point. And so the hope is that some of this work can enter into primary prevention trials, wherein we can identify folks who may have risk for developing Alzheimer's disease by virtue of high amyloid burden and so forth, and then attack that and interrupt that cascade of neurodegeneration at the level of the A-beta accumulations. And so that's where the next phase of some of these clinical trials are going. Well, I just wanted to close with one particular study that we had the opportunity to do. This was actually done in the mid-90s. I think we actually accumulated this data. And it was a sample of convenience where there was a point in time where folks were recruited to our Alzheimer's Center, and our local IRB informed us that we had to disclose to them what their ApoE genotype was. And so we did that with the associated education about what a susceptibility gene is as opposed to what a deterministic gene mutation is, and that they have just an increase in risk for developing the disease and so on and so forth. But the point is that there were a certain number of individuals who then knew what their ApoE genotype was, since that knowledge was disclosed to them. Well, then the IRB changed their minds, and so to this day, we're not allowed to disclose what an individual's ApoE genotype is to him or her. And so we developed this sample of convenience, a 2x2 design, basically, whether you were positive for the, or negative for the ApoE4 allele, and whether you knew it or you didn't know what your gene status was. And these folks were very well matched in terms of age, education, gender distribution. They were clearly non-demented, the DRS total score of 144. So all these folks were 140 or better on average, so clearly non-demented, and their mood states were quite good. And so we gave them an objective memory test as well as a couple of measures of metamemory or subjective memory tests. And when we did that, we basically found that knowing one's gene positivity adversely impacted their objective memory performance relative to those who were gene positive but weren't informed of their gene status, which we found that to be very interesting. And so we saw a significant interaction between one's genetic risk and knowledge of one's genetic risk. on objective memory performance. And we saw a different sort of interaction when it came to their own subjective memory ratings. That is, if they knew that they had the APOE4 allele, they rated their memory capacity as worse than if they didn't know that they were E4 positive. And with the other measure, we were finding a similar type of thing in terms of whether they rated their own memory functioning retrospectively or frequency of forgetting. Each of those two subscales still showed that significant interaction between allele status and knowledge of their allele status. So we summarized those findings such that the presence of the E4 allele and knowledge of that risk interacted to affect both objective memory as well as subjective memory ratings, and that individuals who knew they were gene positive performed less well and rated themselves more harshly in terms of their own memory functioning, whereas those who knew they were not at risk for Alzheimer's disease reported fewer memory concerns than those who did not know that their risk was low. So I believe these results have some important implications as we begin to embrace the use of biomarkers in our field, and they really suggest the need to consider whether an individual knows his or her own risks for dementia when evaluating them, and that there may be a possibility for more false positive diagnoses in those who may know that they carry risks or biomarkers for the disease, and that, or take the case of a primary prevention trial for Alzheimer's disease. If somebody knows that they have a biomarker positivity and they're overrepresented in a placebo or a treatment group, it could adversely affect the results of that particular study. So I think it's very important to identify whether one knows in a person you may be evaluating, whether they know that they have or carry some of these biomarkers. Okay, so let me close with just a few overall summary statements. That first, the relevance of biomarkers, I believe, for the next generation of studies, as well as clinical use of them, is enormous and has led to more sophisticated methods for studying subtle changes in brain structure and function. And if a primary goal of the next generation of therapies is to intervene before the disease has caused its ravages and has atrophied brain structures and various functions, then techniques must be capable of detecting pathology in asymptomatic individuals. And that I believe at the end of the day, a multifaceted approach that integrates a variety of these sources, such as genetic, biomarker, and neuropsychological assessments, will likely be needed to characterize the preclinical phase of dementia. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Absolutely fascinating. A wonderful overview of the field. Thank you very much
Thank
for
you.
Coming.
Thank you.
I had a question that those of us that are progressing along, and that includes everybody here actually, in age, get to a point where there are certain things that, you know, we just don't remember quite as quickly or as well. The first baseman for the Red Sox last year, for example, and just so you won't think it's me, it was Adrian Gonzalez.
That's right.
that there are certain things that are obviously normal for that particular age group, let's say in a 70-year-old person. But if you saw those same things in a 40-year-old or 50-year-old, would they be mild cognitive impairment? And maybe that's a way to talk to some of the 70-year-olds among us who worry about, you know, are they getting, you know, a little bit demented, or at least not as sharp as they were, that, yeah, that's true, but, you know, if you were 50 and had this same problem, it would be clinically important, but at 70, it's not so important.
Yeah, I think you've just beautifully set up the rationale for a neuropsychological assessment, And part of what neuropsychological testing does is to anchor an individual's performance against a normative reference standard. So, as you just pointed out, there may be greater word-finding difficulties in a 70-year-old that is part of normal age-related change in language function. And so anchoring that 70-year-old's performance to a normative reference standard is critical. And so comparing a 40-year-old to a 70-year-old is difficult and it's an untenable proposition without the use of appropriate norms that adjust for age. And so I believe neuropsychology does a very good job of providing standardized tests that are anchored to a variety of normative reference groups of use that can target that particular individual across from you in the clinic. And so I think sophisticated use of cognitive assessment is one of the critical features that it's my contention that we need to grow in terms of the research literature in mild cognitive impairment. Heretofore, it's been a single test, usually a single score, delayed recall of a story from logical memory or the Wechsler memory scale that represents the assay of all of episodic memory for a particular study, and then all of the other domains of cognition are represented by a mini mental state score of 24 to 30. So that is problematical because it does not adequately sample domains of cognition, nor does it provide a sensitive metric, if you will, that's anchored to norms. And so it's my hope that the field moves forward by incorporating not only the sophisticated biomarker usage, but also increasing sophistication in the neuropsychological characterization of these groups. And I think perhaps some of the studies that the Rush University group and Julie Snyder's group might yield some better findings and some better differentiation along those neuropathologic substrates of cognitive subgroups if they characterize their samples better from a cognitive perspective.
I'd like to ask a follow-up to that. You showed us a slide very early with single patients from the Schneider study with the amyloid imaging, I think it was. And you showed individual patients, and you provided us with a look at their imaging and also the mini mental status exam. And one of the things that I noticed was that the normal control had a mini mental status of 30, and the mild cognitive impairment group had a mini mental status of 28, as did the Alzheimer patient, as I recall. Mm-hmm. I wonder if you could comment on that issue in the context of the previous comment.
Yeah, I think that's an important point. And my colleague at UCSD, David Salmon, published a study in neurology in 2002 in which he took a consecutive number of referrals into our Alzheimer Center, all of whom had MMSE scores of 24 to 30 and reliably diagnosed them with early Alzheimer's disease. With about 90% accuracy. So that range of MMSE scores that have been touted in the MCI literature over the years of normalcy or the lack of dementia are really not doing a very good job of excluding dementia. And we've all interacted with folks who get 28, 29, 30 on the mini mental state and still we diagnose them with early Alzheimer's disease based on a comprehensive neuropsychological assessment. So I think global cognitive screening measures are not doing a very good job of helping us out within this domain. If we expect subtle cognitive impairments, then our most blunt instruments, cognitive screening measures, are not going to do a very good job of identifying folks with mild cognitive impairments. And so I think, again, the more sophisticated use of neuropsychological variables will be more and more helpful. I think if we look at those few studies that have taken a single cognitive variable, like overall learning on the Ray Auditory Verbal Learning Test, and compared them alongside, directly compared them to all these other biomarkers and shown they're either comparable or superior to these other biomarkers, just think what we might be able to do if we actually give them an entire battery and profile those individuals in which, and then maybe in some algorithmic way we can say this is a prototypical Alzheimer profile, this is a prototypical mixed profile, this is a prototypical disexecutive profile, and so on. I think we might do a better job at the end of the day joining up those particular types of results to their pathologic substrates.
So being able to acquire comprehensive neuropsychological testing to predict a progression to Alzheimer's, I mean, I think it seems like you're implying that that hasn't been done. And if that's the case, I mean, that technology has been available for decades. I mean, why hasn't it been done?
Multifold, probably, you know, time, resources, directors of studies not being neuropsychologists, any number of factors, I think, would be at play here. Not really sure, but I do know that the prototypical MCI study nowadays is attempting to at least get at the subtypes that I've mentioned with the Peterson and Morris scheme. And so that of necessity requires more cognitive testing than a simple memory measure and the MMSE, right, which was the historical standard. But still, what we're getting at typically is a single test that will represent all of episodic memory, or a single test that represents executive function. So Trails B will represent all of executive function. Boston Naming Test or verbal fluency will represent all of language. And so they're very limited batteries even within these, in these studies. And so they're still not more comprehensively characterizing them. And the other thing is that NIH, for example, has an NIH toolbox, or there's a uniform data set from across that are identified cognitive measures across all Alzheimer's centers, and that's 28 centers nationwide, and people typically can't agree on which measures to give across all 28 centers, and so there's obviously a little bit of tug and pull there in terms of individual studies versus the large national data set repositories. And the original ADNI, Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging Initiative, did a very poor job of diagnosing MCI. It was basically the amnestic domain only that they diagnosed in the original ADNI based on story A of logical memory and MMSE and CDR. And so it's probably, I'm not sure exactly, but it's probably multifaceted why it hasn't taken place. And that's why I encourage people to provide comprehensive neuropsychological evaluations on folks that they want to study, because I think it is going to buy a lot more sensitivity and specificity with respect to these various diagnostic states, above and beyond what we'll be able to do with biomarkers. Andy?
I have a two-part question. So I thought it's interesting to see that both the FDG PET findings and the...
Is this on? And the amyloid beta findings both occur outside of the medial temporal lobe. So the FDG seems to be more in the parietal lobes, and in the amyloid more in the sort of the default mode network. And so I was wondering why that was, that those two biomarkers seem to be falling outside of where you see the neuropathology.
Yeah, I think there are some investigators like Risa Sperling who will tout that there is a certain accumulation of amyloid pathology in some of these hotspots. For example, posterior cingulate. So has obvious implications for the default mode network. It's been known for many, many years about the temporal parietal hypometabolism. And again, it may relate to this broad default network. And it does seem to be more tied to the amyloid in terms of that, if you believe that it has a particular predilection for those hot spots and then potentially downstream or distribution facets of the default network. It's clearly not tied to the tangle pathology, which seems to have a different march through the brain. FDG PET is, it's tough to get at the medial temporal lobe with PET scanning, and it doesn't do a very good job of assaying that critical area. Other measures like structural MR do a better job in terms of volume and cortical thinning of those regions. I think cortical thinning techniques might be helpful too, that really weren't touted within any of the three articles. The free surfer techniques and things like that may be helpful to identify particular regions of cortical thinning, even beyond sort of the more broad-based volumetric changes.
And then the follow-up question is, because I know Grecius had published that paper way back in 2001 or 2002, talking about the default mode and its ability to separate dementia from MCI, even, I believe it was. Are people no longer looking at that? Because I didn't see that as one of the biomarkers that people are really looking at. Is that kind of fallen out of fashion? Or?
Well, I think if you tie it more to the amyloid burden, which Risa again does, then she was mentioning it in her article as a possibility. If you want to go back far enough to look at some of the earliest functional changes occurring in preclinical Alzheimer's disease, the default mode network changes may be helpful, as well as fMRI.
Is anyone working on attempting to visualize the neurofibrillatory tangles in vivo?
Yes, quite a bit. There's quite a bit of activity looking for a tangle-based ligand or not amyloid, but tau imaging technique. I think they may have one that's currently being investigated with great vigor, yeah.
Thank you very much. Great talk.
Thank you, Kathy.